Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Polyhedron Claddercast episode 21. Well, I say 21 because it might not end up being 21 because the last one recorded was episode 20, but we're recording this just before we go to AirCon, and we'll probably record something at AirCon, and I don't know which order I'm going to put them out in. So, let's just say the AirCon's going to be a special.
Hashtag ramshackle.
Well, yeah, stick to our name, haven't we? So that voice you can hear, of course, is Mr. Andy Lewis.
Hello.
Now, we are one man down, but we've made a substitution. So normally, Mr. John Cage would be with us, but he's away on holiday or something at the moment.
He's biking at Centre Parks.
Is he? Oh, Right. Oh, getting some fresh air at least.
Yeah, he's holding up the exercise side of the podcast. Steve and I are good at sitting down and drinking tea. We've got very, very good at that. But it needs to be balanced out with some kind of physical activity.
So instead, we've got Mr. James Hudson from Druid City Games on the line.
What's up, guys?
Welcome along.
Or as I say down here in the South, hey, y'all.
Hey, y'all. See, if we trade accents now, if we have to do it in a British accent, does that mean we have to, us English people have to do the Southern accent?
I think that's a fair trade. I think that's a fair trade.
Excellent. Right then. So should we start? Half the podcast should be done in Queen's English, sipping daintily from a cup of tea.
I don't think either of us two could manage that.
No. We'll go back to dirty Northern like we are now.
When I try to do English accent, it sounds more Australian. And then they usually intertwine, so who knows what would come out of my mouth.
Oh, you're going to have to give it a go now.
Well, like I said, my daughter is 3, so we watch a lot of Peppa Pig, so they say a lot of certain words, like, we're going on holiday.
That wasn't bad.
That's not bad.
I've heard worse.
Yeah, well, you know.
It's better than Russell Crowe. Have you seen Robin Hood? Russell Crowe?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, his accent changes location every 5 lines. He starts off South London, then he's in Wales, then he's in Ireland, then he's Scotland.
Yeah, he probably could have put a little more study into that.
Yeah. So, rather than talking about Russell Crowe's accent, I should probably say with John not here, we've lost our waffle filter. Because usually John is the person who stops us from talking bollocks for too long. And with him not here, well, who knows what's going to happen.
Anything can happen. We're not on the choke chains anymore, so.
No.
Well, you did sub in a redneck, so you got that going for you.
Ooh.
Bit of an interesting substitution, a brummy for a redneck.
Let's see what happens.
Yeah, we'll talk about, really, since you're on, and obviously you hear James talk about your Kickstarter that you're about to launch, I thought we might take a moment to actually talk a bit more in depth about Kickstarter, because although we've mentioned Kickstarter games and what we're backing, we've never really discussed kind of our thoughts on the whole platform as a thing, as an entity.
Sure.
So I thought it was going to go... So it was a good opportunity for us to kind of go over a bit of that. Now, it's worth mentioning a little bit of background, because from the UK, we've got a little bit of a weird perspective on Kickstarter, because when I first got into the hobby, Kickstarter was just growing.
Mm-hmm.
So when I got back into the hobby about 5 or 6 years ago. And there was this really weird situation where technically Kickstarter was illegal in the UK.
Wow. I didn't know that.
It was all to do with the... crowdfunding laws and investment laws. So it's that kind of protection for investors of businesses.
Sure.
Meant that you weren't allowed to crowdfund for an investment as part of the business. And I think that law actually still stands, but what the government or whoever, part of whichever wing of government's in charge of that, basically made an exception for reward-based crowdfunding. So our favourite form of crowdfunding, you know, Kickstarter, where we are backing a project to get a board game at the end of it, that was considered a reward-based. You weren't saying, all right, I'm going to put £200 into an investment into Cool Mini or Not. You're saying, I'm going to go get the next copy of the Cool Mini or Not game.
Yeah, it makes sense, really, because it's essential. I mean, we've touched on this in the past, as you say, Steve. It's something that it's almost like a pre-order, but not quite.
That's right, yeah.
Yeah, and I think actually from a legal standpoint over here, it is almost technically a pre-order.
Yeah, because I know... Is it true, James, in America that if the company basically just, for whatever reason, doesn't manage to deliver the product at the end of it, it's kind of never mind, tough luck. Whereas in the UK, you are legally obligated to provide the goods or the service that you've paid for. So Kickstarter's a bit of a weird entity across the pond. or between the two countries, rather.
Yeah. I mean, it's definitely supposed to be. You're taking a chance. You know, you're investing in a company who may or may not give you your product at the end. So yeah, that does sound very different.
And as soon as they changed these rules, basically all these UK companies were able to come onto Kickstarter, because I think previously they'd all had to have like a proxy address. If you look at Mantic Games were the first big UK company to take part in Kickstarters, and they had to basically sell it from an office in New York.
Right. You know, just work around the system.
Yeah, so according to Kickstarter, Mantic Games are based in New York, when in fact they're based in Nottingham, so...
Wow.
There's a loophole somewhere, right?
Oh, there's always a loophole, yeah. There's always a way to get around the system, isn't it?
Yeah. Do you guys typically back a lot of Kickstarters?
Do I have to answer this honestly?
You're not under oath, but go on, then.
Yes. I've backed, I think I've on to 17 now, since April last year, which is pretty much when I first started. And I think 5 of them have sort of shipped to me now. There's a couple on their way, and then the rest of them are kind of due over the next few months towards the end of 2017. So it's something I've kind of invested a lot of time and money into, yes.
I'm a bit less than Andy in that regard. I think I've backed more or less the same number of projects. I think we counted up the other day when we were discussing Andy, and I think it was about 20 projects I think I'd backed.
Okay. Yeah, something like that.
In like the last 3 or 4 years. But I'm a bit more risk-averse, so I don't tend to back as much stuff as other people. I found some projects, by the time they come over here, I mean, we'll get onto this a little bit when we talk about your project, James. Some projects, because they're all typically American-based, mm-hmm. you tend to find that by the time you'd paid for import duty and shipping and the dreaded postal office administration fee, you'd end up paying a lot more to get a Kickstarter than you would if you just waited to come out in the shops.
That's right. Yeah, that's, you know, that's one of the things I'm trying to combat on my end, because typically, like, a lot of the breakdown numbers is 50% is U.S., 25% of your backers are from the EU, about 10% from Canada, 10% from Australia, and then the rest come from all over the place. And so, you know, you're talking about 25% of your potential market who won't back something. I feel like those numbers would probably go up a lot more if the shipping situation weren't so disgusting as they are. So that's one of the things that we're trying to tackle in our campaigns coming up.
Yeah, I mean, I felt it actually quite a lot recently with Game Planetarium from Game Salute. It recently shipped. The game itself was only $29, as it made in America. And I thought, brilliant, it's great value for that amount of money. But it cost $20 to ship the bloody thing. It was almost, you know, almost 100% on top just to get it to the EU. Whereas the shipping in the States, I think, was something like $8. It's nothing.
Yeah, it's tough, because like when I look at my rates for my game is going to be a big box game, or a big box, normal size. So, gosh, I'm going to say inches, and you guys don't even know what I'm talking about. 12-inch by 12-inch, so like 300 millimeter by centimeter by 300-ish. Yep. Probably kind of your standard game box. And, you know, it's roughly, it's usually in the 1.5 to 2 kg range on weight. So that's a pretty substantial cost to ship. And so, yeah, the shipping costs are, say, anywhere from $9 to $15 through DHL. But then as soon as my ocean freighter hits the port, it's a 20% on everything in my container, the whole value. So that's really where we get jacked on the cost, because they all just start the money to get the ocean freighter there, then the 20% value added tax, and then the shipping. So it's just like it's got to come from somewhere.
Yeah, it's tax on tax on tax, isn't it? It's just insane.
So like on my campaign, you know, I'm gonna absorb the about $15 of that cost. That's the only way I can see to be able to get everybody in the EU a decent, normal shipping rate. So I'm hoping that I'm going to roll that into my pledge price, and then EU should only have to attack on another $10 US to cover everything else.
That's not terrible.
Yeah, that's good. I could handle that.
Yeah, $59 is where our pledge is going to be. So, you know, when you, as you were talking about earlier, $29 game and $20 shipping, it almost doubles the price, whereas this is going to be a $59 game and only $10 for shipping. So, and MSRP is going to be $59 when it goes to retail. So it's not like I should wait. I'm going to get a big, big discount when it goes to retail. It's roughly the same. You're actually getting some early access there. So that's our plan. It might bite us in the butt, but we're going to go for it.
If you don't ask, you don't get, do you? So it sounds good.
So where are you shipping to, by the way? You said you're shipping into the EU. Is that going to be into the UK, or is that somewhere else on the...
We're going to be actually shipping into Germany. Yeah, our fulfillment center's in Germany.
Okay. That's pretty good. It's pretty central, so it makes sense. In fact, it doesn't take long to get from Germany to pretty much anywhere in Europe, so it's usually a couple of days of shipping time. It's easy peasy.
Yeah, see, it's so easy because, you know, Europe's so... Overall, landmass is so small compared to the U.S. So, like, when I ship our stuff into – it comes in on the West Coast, it'll take 5 to 7 days for it to get to the East Coast. You guys are all, like, nice and cozy there. So, yeah, that's one day. Just bounce that around.
Pretty much. It's just a train jam. I mean, you can get from London to Paris in about an hour and a half on the train. It's insane.
Yeah, I'm hoping to come over for Essen this year. I'm hoping Grimm does fantastic where I have a reason to come over, but, you know, not other than just coming over to do the awesome show. But I've never been across the pond, as you said earlier, so I'm looking forward to that.
Oh, well, we will look forward to seeing you if you come.
Yeah, Essen is a bit of a... It's quite an eye-opener, Essen, I think.
Of course, yeah, you've done it, haven't you? I've not been yet.
Yeah, I did it not last year, the year before. It's quite bizarre because it is just a trade show. So there's no open gaming or anything like that. It's just you go to see and buy games and you see people buying games. I mean, they've got carts. Like, I swear some of them need to bring little forklift trucks with them, the amount of the carting around.
You want to see the games I'm taking to Aircon tomorrow? I think I need a forklift for that.
Yeah, I have seen some people's... I'm doing air quotes right now. I know we're not on visual, but haul pictures, you know, where they've hauled in all these games. And I'm like, first, wow at the credit card limit you must have, because I know you didn't just bring cash.
Oh, yeah, too.
And, you know, how are you going to get all this stuff home? Because these are people that you're not... Are you in driving distance? Maybe. I don't know. Seems crazy.
See, I flew over when I went a couple of years back, and I'd tessellated some suitcases. So I just took two suitcases, one inside the other, and then everything else inside was bare minimum. You know, I was there for 3 days. It was basically enough clothes for 3 days, toothbrush, toothpaste, and that was about it.
One pair of pants.
Yeah. And I was so gutted because I'd even I'd filled both suitcases with games. I knew what my weight limit was, and I kept thinking, there was one or two games. I thought, oh, I could get that. I could probably fit it in, but I don't know if it'd be within my weight limit. And there's nothing more crushing than getting to Dusseldorf Airport, weighing your luggage, and finding your 5 kilos under your limit. I could have got 3 more games in there.
Curses.
Next year, bring a scale.
Yes.
Yeah. There you go. There you go, Tudor. You've learned. You need to be prepared.
When have I ever been prepared?
Well, there is that, yes. So what are we talking about tonight, Steve? I've no idea. When was this? 5 minutes before the podcast.
5 minutes before? That's organisation, that is.
That's true.
Just in time, that is.
Oh, aye. Right. I'm going to try and yank us back on course now.
Bloody hell.
I know. Well,
it's John taking over.
Well, We've been on the subject of James's game. So whilst we're on there, what will you actually be sending to Germany, James?
Yeah. So the game Grimm Forest is Tim Eisner is the designer. He did March of Ants. I don't know if you've seen that game, but he is a little mad scientist, little guy. And Gen Con. I say little. He's like 6'5". Met him at Gen Con last year, and he had a game that he was pitching. And I was like, cool, can I see it? You know, I know I'm a little indie publisher. I have no reason to try to pick you up, but, you know, I'd like to just play your game. So we play it, and it's phenomenal. It was my favorite game of Gen Con, and I'm talking all the games there. And so I begged him for it, begged him for it. I don't know if you guys are familiar with Saving Mr. Banks, the movie about Walt Disney trying to track down P.L. Travers and get Mary Poppins. but it was a
I've heard of it.
Not the chance to see it. Yeah,
you should watch it. As creative people, it's very interesting. But she was not having it, and so Walt Disney had to do some convincing. So that was me. I'm like, I know I'm nobody, and my first Kickstarter did $17,000, so I'm still a speck in nothing. But please let me have it. I'll make it awesome. And so anyway, I eventually bribed him enough to let me have it, and here we are. And so in the game, you're in the Grimm Forest world, right? You're relatives of the three little pigs, and you're building houses, and you need resources. And so you go out to different locations to gather resources. Well, you're trying to deduce what everyone else is doing because you're secretly playing where you're going to go. And if you go to a place by yourself, you get all the resources. So let's just say there's five straw there. But if me and you, Stephen, both go to the woods, we have to split the four wood that's there. So I only get two and you get two. And so you need the resources to build your houses. And there's floors, there's walls, and there's roofs. And so through that, you know, that sounds pretty simple, pretty straightforward. But there's also fable cards that you take and you play down with where you're going to go. And they're revealed in turn order. So it starts getting kind of hectic with the different powers that people lay on top of where they're going to go. And then so then you do a build action, and the first person who builds three houses triggers the end game. And there's some of the classics, like Big Bad Wolf, Bridge Trolls, regular wolves, the Evil Queen's in there. So, I mean, my art team is Mr. Cuttington. They did their most recent game was Unfair, but they did Santorini. They did Steampunk Rally, Super Mother Load. Okay. So the art is unbelievable. It is. I really think Disney's going to call and say, we want to buy the rights to this and do a series. Like, we need to put this on TV. It's that good. And, you know, it's going to end up having six, hopefully up to 10 miniatures that are in the game. We got to hit some stretch goals to get the rest of them in. But overall, the production is really high quality and high-end components because I feel like there's a ton of replayability in the game. Because every time I've played it, it's played out differently. And it plays a little bit different at two-player and at four-player. So, it's something that you can throw down. I would say it probably weight-wise, because I know probably a lot of listeners want to know the weight of the game. You know, it's a 45-minute to 60-minute type of game that I would say it's medium weight with a little bit of take that. And, Gateway Plus, I would say it's probably a hard Gateway Plus. It's not a gateway game because there's some of those card powers really start overlaying and can get a little tricky if you're not careful. But for the most part, I would say it's Gateway Plus. But you could throw it down in front of anyone because it just looks so appealing on the table.
I have to admit, I've seen somebody. I went to your website earlier today. Steve and I were sort of talking, obviously, about preparation. You know, we did some prep, actually, which is unheard of.
You just wanted to make sure it wasn't total garbage. I understand.
Yeah, that too. But I have to admit, I really love the look of it. I mean, you're right. The artwork looks spectacular. The images of the three pigs and the wolf, and then the design of the minis on top as well, was sort of the brick house with the roof, the sort of the exploded roof. It all looks fantastic. Really, really. I suppose in keeping with the theme is my impression of it is that it's really, really beautifully designed and artwork. And obviously you've got the Grimm fairy tale, so everything's a bit fantastical, but a little bit magical and a little bit cartoony as well. It all looks really, really cool.
Yeah, it was one of those things where I felt like I'm so tired of seeing zombies. And wait, I'll have a zombie game next year that I'm publishing. But, I'm tired of seeing zombies. And all the tropes, right? And so when I saw this game, I was like, wow. You know, and there are some fairy tale games, but there's not any I feel like have done a really good job of still being a good gamer's game. You know, they're usually targeted toward family and children. And so, I think this is something that you could play with an advanced kid. They've got to be able to read really well and understand strategy. You know, it's probably going to be more like a 10, 11, 12 plus kind of range. But yeah, and there's something just really fun about physically building those houses, you know. It kind of has a Santorini feel where you've got that floor and the walls and the roof, and then you get rewards when you build walls and you get rewards when you build a roof. And that's when the friends come in, so you've got those fable cards, but the friend cards are all of the classic fairy tale characters, so Snow White, Cinderella, there's a bunch of gremlins in there.
It sounds a little bit like almost like I don't know if you heard a stage play or seen a stage play Into the Woods. I think Disney made a film of it actually recently. Which is kind of like a mishmash of all of the fairy tales. So you have you got Red Riding Hood and all that lot all in there and all mixed up. So that sounds fantastic. It really does. And an hour as well. It's very accessible.
You know, we did dip into a few other fairy tales to grab a few people like Robin Hood and brought Robin Hood in. But for the most part, you know, there's like 100 plus stories in the Grimm fairy tales. So when you start digging into them, there's a lot of stories that I didn't realize, oh, that's actually part of this. Or, you know, I just thought I thought Disney owned everything, but they don't. They actually took a lot of it and remade it themselves.
Oh, totally. Yeah. The Grimms have been around a lot longer than Disney has, I'm sure. So
you've said some dumb things in your time, Andy, but that's going to take the biscuit.
Yeah, totally. I know. And the Grimms have been around for hundreds of years, haven't they?
Yes. Of which most of the tales as well are, I think, I get confused which came first, whether it was Hans Christian Andersen or Grimm as the kind of collectors, but it's about 1700s, 1800s, I think.
I think it was Hans Christian Andersen, but I don't quote me on that.
And then most of those tales are kind of folk tales anyway, so most of them are hundreds of years old as they are, you know.
Mm. Yeah, but Disney did it first, mate.
Yeah, of course. Well, it's like whenever you see these like artists and that doing, oh, we're going to do some dark versions of fairy tales, and it's like, no, that's just the fairy tale.
Yeah,
Disney have made it all
written,
nice and sweet.
Yeah. Like Hansel and Gretel is not a nice story.
No. There are definitely. I started reading a few of them as I was doing my research, and I was like, wow, this is dark. This is kind of. I would definitely not read this to children.
I was going to say, would you read it to your daughter?
No. And, you know, I think Fantasy Flight did a game, Winter Tales, a couple years back. It was a pretty shit game, actually, as far as game goes. And I think if you went and talked to anybody there, they would almost tell you they agreed. But the artwork was really interesting. It had that noir kind of fairy tale look to it. It's definitely something we looked into when we were researching. We tried to research all the fairy tale games before we picked this up and started working on it. You know, we wanted to be very unique in what we did.
I'm trying to think of a fairy tale game that's actually been any good. And you've just given me a third one, two to mind that were pretty rubbish. And Winter's Tale, I've not played Winter's Tale, but I've not heard a single good thing about it. So
don't do it.
We've got our hopes pinned on you here, James. I hope you realise that.
Yeah, you're carrying the torch now, man.
Yeah, I really think, you know, I keep putting it in front of people, right? Especially people in the industry. And I'm like, they play it, and I always cringe, you know, because when you make something and you put it in front of somebody, you know, you guys, you put a podcast out there for the first time, right? The first time you're like, are people going to call in and call us idiots? You know, and so you just have that apprehension, you're waiting, and everybody keeps saying they love it, and there's nothing that would change about it, which that's a good sign for me.
I'm assuming you're talking about your game and not our podcast, because I'm pretty sure our podcast is terrible.
Well, you know.
The irony is as well, our biggest fan called us idiots most of the time on Twitter, so.
That is true, yeah. So, I mean, how long, you say you've talked, obviously you've done your research into Grimm and all that lot, James. I mean, how long have you actually been developing the game for? Because, I mean, obviously, you know, reading 1700 fairy tales is going to take you some time.
Yeah, we didn't make it through all those. But luckily, there's quite a few of us on the team, so we kind of split that up into different duties. You know, I wouldn't say I have any sort of extensive research wisdom on all the fairy tales, but I have a very good overview of the majority of them. And, you know, we really started really hammering this out in probably October is when we really started picking up development. But this was a game before. So Tim had already tried to launch this once on Kickstarter a year previously. So the game's been in development for about 2 years overall. It was called Little Pigs then. And I had a totally different vision for the game, and then obviously a way different component set up with miniatures and building the houses and things like that. So
cool. Wow. So geez, 2 years. That's quite a lot. I would say it sounds like quite a lot, but from other people and you know, the Kickstarter projects, it sounds about par for the course, I'd reckon.
Yeah, that's you know, if you develop it much faster than that, it's going to have to be a really simple game, because it just, when you go through playtesting, and especially blind playtesting, where you send the game off to somebody that you're not standing there to kind of shuffle them along, that all that feedback and building the things out, it just takes time.
Yeah,
I'm sorry, well, due to your accent there, I heard that as blonde playtesting rather than blind playtesting.
Blind? It was blind playtesting? No, that's Texas. I'm sorry.
Blonde playtesting. We've got a load of Swedish people in the room, and they better not it.
I don't know. It sounds quite good to me.
I kind of wanted to ask some questions regarding the little houses, actually. I'm a bit of a... My history is I'm a mechanical engineer, so I've been involved in manufacturing for years. So I'm always intrigued when people come up with components, how they go about them, really. So one of the things you see on most of the publicity shots you've shown so far are these little houses which you build. So how did you approach getting these made? Well, I mean, were these right from the start? Were they tokens? Or did you always intend them to be miniatures?
Yeah, you know, in Tim's version, they were just wooden blocks. You know, you had a flat wooden square for the floor. You had a regular cube for the walls. And then you had a triangular type of shape for the roof, which was fine. Totally worked mechanically. But I know everybody hates this terminology, an Ameritrasher. You know, I lean more to those type of games, and what I have in front of me is important. How it looks and the theme, I love that. Not to say that I can't get into any of the driest Euros known to man. I still like engine building, don't get me wrong. But so when I reached out to my art team, I was like, what would these look like if we, you know, developed them where they could actually interlock together? And so when you were building them, it felt like you were building a house. And so they came up with some 3D models. You know, we're going to have to build molds, and it'll be the PVC injection type of stuff, and it'll be colored so you can dummy proof it and can't try to put a straw wall on a brick floor and that sort of thing. And, you know, because that's the main gig of the game is you have to have the correct resource to build that part of the house. So if you've got six straw, you can build a straw roof. You can't build a brick roof. So depending on your strategy and what you're trying to build, that's how you go about it.
So can you build like a combination house then, or is it all like you go for a brick house, straw house?
Yeah, once you're done, you've got to have one a full brick house or a full wood house. You can build, it don't matter what kind of the three houses. You could, if you want to do three straw, you can do three straw. But the tiebreaker at the end of the game, if we've both built three homes at the end of the same round, is who's built the three sturdiest houses. So you get rewarded for building the house that's harder to build. And there's less brick than there is straw and than there is of wood available. So it's harder to build.
Okay.
But you get that reward at the end.
Sure. Okay, that makes sense. I was about to ask, you've just answered my question. I was going to say, you know, it's presumably then brick is either harder to get and or, you know, you get more reward for it. So, excellent.
And all the card powers tie into a lot of the fables as far in fairy tales. So, you know, when you start digging into the card powers, you see if somebody plays the big bad wolf, they actually can play it on a location before people reveal where they're going. So you're trying to guess, you know. So let's say, I'm trying to remember some of the other Euro games that have this mechanic. But so if no one goes to the brickyard in a round, the three brick that are out there, when you refresh at the end of the round, three more brick come out. So now that brickyard has six brick. And so, it's, you know, the bounty is much more enticing. Well, you might – there's certain creatures that you can play and lay actually on locations, and it has certain effects. Well, the big bad wolf is a type of card you can play, and if you play him and you catch a pig there, he blows down a piece of house that is not brick. So, you know, he's probably one of the most nasty take that cards we have. But for the most part, it's just swapping and activating abilities.
Okay. Oh, sounds cool. So what – slightly related to the development then. I mean, something I'm curious about because I used to be a project manager, and I'm kind of currently running a project team at the moment, well, kind of a business team at the moment. It's always something that – at what point do you get kind of Kickstarter involved? Because, you know, you've obviously developed the game, you've got an idea. There's no point in getting them start straight away. So when do you kick that off? Because presumably you need to know what your costs are and all that sort of stuff. But then...
Yeah, it's a... I think everyone who does it has a little bit different method of getting to the point where they're two thumbs up and ready to go. For us, it is once we feel like the game is where we want it play-wise, and we have all the rules. Because to me, the most important part is the play mechanics. Is, you know, is it fully tested? Is it fully vetted? Do we have our rule book ready? From there, you know, at the whole time, I'm sending stuff to my manufacturer in China and getting quotes. They hate me because I update quotes once a week. I mean, I bet I get cussed out weekly there. But that's just the way it goes, you know. And the more I do this, the more I'm learning certain things aren't plausible, so you figure things out along the way. But
sorry, does the when you get Kickstarter involved, presumably you get your quote, you update your quotes and all sorts. So presumably that does that shape what you do with the game from then on. So for example, you know, you get the Kickstarter costs, you get the shipping costs, and all of a sudden, oh crap, you know, these miniatures cost a bloody fortune. Shit, do we need to scale them down? Can we scale them up? All that sort of stuff.
Yeah, that's that. All of it kind of, it's kind of like baking a cake. You know, if you don't have any eggs and you go to open the fridge and you get the eggs out and there's no eggs, it makes it hard to make the cake, right? And so it's a lot of prep as far as knowing all the pieces that are going to go into it. You really, I think people have really screwed themselves over with not having everything prepped before they go to Kickstarter. That will not be our case, because I'm crazy on the details on that side of things, because I do not want to get stuck with something I wasn't expecting. Not to say that it can't still happen. But overall, you've got to kind of have your formula put together for the most part. Like, we've got the majority of the stretch goals that we would like to see in the game mapped out. And, you know, we've got those quoted. We know, like, there's some pretty – we've got some miniatures that we want to add to the game that are big and chunky, and the molds are very expensive. And that's just something that wouldn't be in the game if we didn't go to Kickstarter and get the volume, so we can get those economy of scales working, so that we can up our units and pass that along. And yeah, it's really complicated, and I see why people don't do it well. I didn't do it well to begin with, and I'm getting better as I go.
It's just brought up a couple of things I was thinking, actually. The first thing, stretch goals. We're recording this, I think, 2 days after Rising Sun has just launched on Kickstarter. So it's probably going to be one of the biggest tabletop Kickstarters of the year. But it looks to me, and this is a hunch, that what Simon are doing is like a dynamic stretch goal. So they're not saying right from the beginning, oh, the stretch goals are going to be this, this, and this for, I don't know, 12,000, 120,000, such and such. It almost, because they're teasing them out, it almost looks like they're changing the stretch goal based on where they are at the moment. Now, is that something you've considered, or are you just going, right, I know it's going to cost me 50 grand to make the molds for these injection molded miniatures, so that's my stretch goal for them?
You know, it's a combination, because, and I'm just going to be totally transparent, because I think a lot of times these companies do a little bit of the, and I'm not saying this about CMON, I love their model, and someday I hope to have their success. But
I think we all do.
I will have their success. How about that? But the problem is, if you set everything on the front end and you come out and you do fantastic and you blow through all your stretch goals 2 days in, then you have no stretch goals for the rest of the campaign. You're kind of up the creek without your paddle, right? And some people would say, well, that shouldn't matter. If those are the numbers that you need, then that's all you need and it doesn't matter. Well, that's fine, but let's be honest, that's not how everybody else works. Most people want those things that they're building for. So I would say it's a combination of a few. Like, there are some of my stretch goals that if we don't hit certain numbers, they just will not exist, because those molds have a huge upfront cost before you even start printing the game. And they, you know, they want 100% of that money beforehand. So, yeah, I wish it was you could be a little bit more straightforward, but you've got to say, hey, this is, we've got 22 stretch goals that are going to happen during the campaign, and here's the first three, you know, and here's the numbers for those.
Yeah. You can see this kind of social engineering, as it were, going on, because you watch the Kickstarters that do really well, and they drip feed that information to keep people coming back and going for add-ons, or, you know, or somebody who's dilly-dallying, should I back it or not, coming back later and going, oh, well, it's unlocked all this now, I'm going to go for it, and there's still more to unlock.
Yep, yep. Yeah, I wish I could really just throw it all out there and say,
for me, actually,
here's the number that I need, let's do it, you know, here's the game. But yeah, we are taking a little bit of that approach, too, because we're going to put everything in the box. We're not doing any add-ons. We're only going to have one exclusive, and it's, you know, it's not your typical exclusive. It's a box sleeve. So, Mr. Cuddington, because they're unbelievable, fantastic artists, I wanted to turn them loose on a box cover. And so it'll sleeve over, I can't say the word, but the game that just came out, Anachrony, did I say it right?
Yeah, yeah.
That sounds right to me.
I'm a redneck again, so I want to say a crony.
It's Anachrony, yes, it's right.
Yeah, Anachrony has a really great box sleeve that you got to choose between four factions, and that was only exclusive to the Kickstarter. And so on that end, I want to deliver to the retail market a similar game where, you know, is like Cool Mini is going to have a bajillion miniature exclusives in their box. So we're just have a little bit different model. I want to say it's $59. That includes almost all the shipping. Here's all the stuff that we want to put into it. Get on board. I want to keep it pretty simple.
So how long a campaign are you going for? Because I've heard some people say that can have a big effect on kind of what funding levels you get, is how long you actually run the project for.
Yeah, we're going to go from March 21st to April 14th. So it's like 26 or 27 days, something like that. So it's right inside the 30-day window. I prefer more of a 24-day window, but you have to take into account starting on a middle of the week and then ending on a Friday, because if you don't end on a Friday, some people haven't been paid, and you will not – That credit card will not process, boys and girls. It will get ka-ching, bounce it.
So can you customize the length of a campaign then to a certain extent? Is there like rules within Kickstarter that says, right, it must be 15 days or 45 days or whatever?
Up to 60. So you can do anything that you want from 1 to 60.
Oh, right. Okay.
It's quite rare that projects go to 60 days these days, though, isn't it? Because
it is. No, even in a 30-day campaign, you really see the majority of your action in the first week and the last week. And those 2 weeks in the middle are kind of lulls. But as someone like me who's still new and people don't know who Druid City Games are, then it's necessary to drag it out to 30 days so that if people happen to find upon you, they can get involved.
Yeah, because it always takes you know, a couple of weeks for word to spread, doesn't it? You know, people jump on the bandwagon to start with. You know, people have heard of you in the first week, and as you say, then there's the lull as you hope word starts to spread, and then in the last week they all sort of jump on it. Go, oh, this is pretty cool. Let's bag this.
And it's similar to why Jamie Stegmaier has kind of backed out of Kickstarter with Charterstone, because there's so much work that goes into prepping a campaign for Kickstarter and all the assets that you got to have and that sort of thing. Whereas he's built his audience to the point now that he doesn't need it, and there's no point in wasting all of that time and effort. It's not really about the 5%, I don't think, at least from when I've talked to him. It's more about the time that you lose prepping a campaign as opposed to saying, hey, Charterstone will be available in August, so pre-order, go.
Yeah, which is quite refreshing, because I think he's not even doing like a pre-order Kickstarter stretch goal system, isn't it? Like Portal Games just did their Martians game, which worked on a similar system to Kickstarter, where the more pre-orders it got, the more bits and pieces unlocked for the game. I think Jamie said he's just putting Charterstone out there as it is, isn't he?
Yep, he's going straight to retail. That's, again, that's the level that you hope to get to as a publisher, that you've got a big enough, you know, ball of wax rolling down the hill that you can do that. And, you know, Jamie, he's done that by making fantastic games. You know, that's the key. Like, his productions are unreal. Like, the components are unreal. The gameplay is fantastic. It's a guaranteed enjoyable game. Even if you, you know, you want to get into BGG and you rate one a 9 and one a 7, he hasn't put out a 4. He hasn't put out a 5.
No, that's true. I do like me a bit of Stonemaier, so I haven't played a bad one yet.
I still play Viticulture all the time. It's one of my wife's favorite games.
Yeah, it is my favorite game as well. Play it with my girlfriend all the time, and we still love it. I mean, I've got Tuscany as well. I was fortunate last year. I found like one of 6 copies floating about the UK. And I was like, right, I'm having that. That's not getting out of here without my name on it.
I remember that steely look in your eye at the UK Games Expo, actually. It was quite terrifying for the person selling it, yeah.
No, that's mine. Juliet, you are not selling that to anyone else.
My precious.
Exactly. I have to say, it was really worth it. It's a fantastic expansion.
Yeah.
So did you ever consider, I mean, it almost sounds like a stupid question, this, but did you ever consider making it yourself and not going via Kickstarter?
You know, there's really the only other way to produce a game and not go Kickstarter when you're a complete unknown is to either be financially rich beyond imagine, so you're going to need a ton of capital, or just to be a designer and pitch your game to publishers and put it and, you know, go that route and just get a percentage, but you're still not going to be a publisher. At this point, all of the eyeballs that are willing to take a chance on somebody new, they're all on Kickstarter. They're all waiting. You know, they're that crowd is just churning through games every day, hitting explore, typing in board game. What is out there? It's just where the markets went. So you either play the game or you don't get in the race.
it's like the only designer, really, the publisher I know doesn't really use Kickstarter, that's kind of the same kind of size, is Medusa Games and Richard Denning. He's a UK publisher who does very, very small batches, but he's also the guy who organises UK Games Expo, which is our biggest games convention. So slap bang in the middle of last year's UK Games Expo was a Medusa Games stand selling his latest game, The Nine Worlds. So he didn't go for that Kickstarter route because, well, he's already got a platform which he can market his games.
Yeah, he's got 25,000 people going, ooh, new shiny game.
Yeah, Renegade. Renegade's one that I think is a good example of a company who doesn't use Kickstarter and who just kind of surfaced to produce, you know, and get off the ground and have made a huge splash. But also Scott and Erica, they've worked at other board gaming companies. So, you know, somebody like me who's just a redneck who had a board game idea and said, oh, I'll figure out how to do this myself. It's Kickstarter is really the only way to go about it.
I think, isn't it Jeff Engelstein quote, you'd be stupid as a publisher not to go to Kickstarter, because it's just from a business point of view, it makes absolute perfect sense.
Of course, you're basically offloading the risk onto everyone else, aren't you? You know, you know exactly what your budget is. As you say, James, you've hopefully, if you're sensible about it, you've done your research up front, so you know exactly what's involved. All you need is the dosh. Once you've got the dosh, press the big green button and away you go.
You know, say 10 years ago before Kickstarter, I would have taken my first game and I would have either took out a big loan or borrowed money. I'd have spent all the money to manufacture it. I would have had 3,000 copies, and then I'd have went, hey, world, here it is. Who wants it? And either I have a hit and I sell them all, or I have a garage full of games for the rest of my life. And now I have no retirement because I spent it all.
Yeah.
You know, it's a great way to vet the market. That's one of the main reasons why you see, like, Munchkin, right? Munchkin has a project on Kickstarter right now for Shakespeare, because it's such a niche type of brand, right? They're able to go on to Kickstarter, and this is the first time Steve Jackson Games has actually went on to Kickstarter.
Apart from Ogre. Yeah, Ogre, but that was a bit different. Ogre was, because that was like a massive boutique game. That was that was a Kickstarter to make something that's never going to go into production. So
that's right. Yeah, I think it was huge.
quite literally.
Where's the, that's what she said. Am I in the right room? Where am I?
Andy obviously wasn't paying attention at that point.
Andy's being reserved.
Yeah, so it allows them to go on and see if a Shakespeare thing is going to, you know, is that going to resonate with their audience? And, you know, they might go out and manufacture 50,000 copies, but if they don't sell them, then they take a big hit, and that hurts business. And so Cool Mini does the same thing. I think, you know, the campaign before Rising Sun, The Rise of Moloch, you know, it's a very niche market that's going to enjoy a steampunk dungeon crawl. And so, you know, you can see how many of those that you need to print.
That sounds awesome. Where do I sign for that? I love steampunk.
You've missed out on that one, fella.
God damn it.
Don't worry. They'll be happy to sell you a copy.
Oh, I'm sure they will.
Oh, yes.
I'm probably happy to buy one.
I was tempted to whip with that World of Smogworm, not because of the game itself, because the miniatures are actually redos of a previous... Oh God, I can't remember the name of the company now. But this World of Smog is not a Simon property. It's quite an older property. And some of those miniatures were available about 3 or 4 years ago from a Polish company. And that Polish company disappeared. And I saw some of those miniatures and went, I almost backed it just for the minis. And I know that's not the thing to do.
No, it's fine. I mean, that's one of the things for me, especially on a cool mini game, that I know that if I hate the game, I'm at least going to be able to get my money back out of it. I'm not going to lose any money.
Yeah, true.
You know, there's plenty of speculators that buy all of them just with put them on eBay and cash in. I don't like doing that just because I want to spread the love around on the game. But, you know, I am sitting on a copy of Gloomhaven right now. I don't know if I'm ever going to get to play that. Yeah.
I mean, if you don't want it, you know, I mean, it's not that far across the pond.
It would only cost $6,000 to ship this 78-pound box to the UK.
A bargain.
Yeah, that's still cheaper than I can buy it on eBay over here.
When you ship your game to Germany, stick it in the container. I'll happily pick it up from Germany. It's fine.
No problem. You just hang out and wait for that.
Totally. It'll need an ISO container of its own, I think.
I did get to play a session. I was on Man vs. Meeple. I don't know if you guys have followed them at all, but I got to play session with them, with the graphic designer from the game, Josh McDowell, I believe is his name. And it is phenomenal. I don't know if you guys have got to play it, but it is a masterpiece.
No, none of us know, neither of us actually know anyone who's got it, annoyingly. I mean, it's Steve's former group now because he's moved, but the Worcester crowd that I play with on a Tuesday, of like 15 or 20 board gamers there, nobody backed Gloomhaven. We're all like, nobody did. What, really? That was an administrative oversight there, I think.
Whoops.
And there's some serial Kickstarter backers in that group. There really are.
Oh, there are, yeah. There's me, there's Niall, there's Dan, there's...
No, it is a complete and total masterpiece. There's a couple of things I could nitpick, but when you've got that much content, you're going to have something that somebody doesn't like as much as another. But as far as, like, delivering the quality and content for money, you... Give me a break.
Yeah.
I don't even want to make my game compared to his.
Actually, whilst on the subject of boxes full of stuff, James, you've kind of touched on a subject that Steve and I have been mulling over for a couple of weeks, actually. And it's kind of kicked off on Facebook recently with, I suppose it's been exacerbated with the recent release of Rising Sun, because everyone's just gone bananas over it, obviously, is, I suppose, the cost of Kickstarter. I mean, it's something that Steve feel quite strongly about. And we've had a couple of discussions about it recently, is that we do feel that, generally speaking, I mean, if there's a lot of reasons for it, that Kickstarters seem to be getting more expensive over the last, 6 to 12 months or so. There's obviously a lot of reasons for that. I mean, we've got Brexit, there's, the cost of miniatures, people are throwing minis at things just to sell and all this sort of jazz. But you've just mentioned something I'm actually a big fan of, is that I think they are more expensive, generally, even just by £5 or £10, but you do seem to get more in the box with a Kickstarter campaign. So whilst you're paying more, you're getting a lot more for your money, basically. So I'm still a big supporter of saying that they're actually quite good value for money, generally. I mean, there's still some hounds out there. You know, you're always going to get one dodgy one that thinks, oh, hang on a minute, that's a bit steep. Because there's a bit of controversy and discussion on the reprint of Terraforming Mars at the moment, which Steve got pulled into a discussion the other day.
Yeah, I rose when I shouldn't have, I think. Yeah, that XKCD, isn't XKCD comic? When the guy chats to his wife and he's storming off and it's like, where are you going? Someone is wrong on the internet. I need to correct them.
It's very good. But it is, I suppose, a legit concern, because, I mean, it does come back to, I mean, you've talked about, obviously, generating stretch goals and add-ons and all this sort of stuff. And I mean, I'm guilty of it. I know Steve is, that we've both backed games that have day one expansions, add-ons, all this sort of stuff. So, I mean, where do you feel it? I mean, it sits, because it's obviously quite a divisive, contentious subject. You know, some people don't mind it. Some people are happy to spend $300 on a minis game and get, all the expansions on day one. I mean, what do you think?
Yeah, the big issue, I think, is, so the margins are slim, right? Just across the board, there's no one is getting rich in board gaming. I don't, so I want to say that first. even if you look at these big companies, and I'm air quoting again, big companies, compared to, like, say, a video game industry, I mean, we don't have the numbers and the margins that some of these other industries do. And so, I'm learning that firsthand. And so when you go to distribution and to retail with your product, I mean, they ask for a pretty substantial discount off of your MSRP. So you've got to make a game at a certain price and it be worth a certain amount of money so that when you go to distribution and retail, there's enough money left over to even make anything on a unit. So part of that, the other thing, I think, so that's the business side of things. And to really probably dive into your question more, is that people just demand more out of a game. So, 3 years ago when we looked at Kickstarter, you could almost bring half finished art to the table and say, here's my game idea. I need 10 grand to make this thing. And people would get behind it. But, the level of what people are looking for out of a game has risen so much. You've got to come with a fully fleshed out game. And not just that, you can't just have a good idea or a good game. You've got to have a great game. I mean, I see good games get passed over often. I do a few reviews for my YouTube channel, and I have people send me Kickstarters and prototypes, and I'm like, man, this is a good game, but it's not a great game, and you know, it's only going to do so good. So it's just kind of the environment. I think it's good because now we get great games, right? The only thing that rises to the top are great games. I mean, look at 2016. Look at all the different top 10 videos out there, right, that all the different talking heads put out. Everybody had a bunch of different ones, but they were all viable to be top 10s because there was that many great games last year.
And the thing is, it's a complicated subject because there's a lot to talk about in there. And I mean, I know even just the three of us at Polyhedron Collider have all sort of got a different idea of what our favourite of 2016 was. I mean, Steve and I basically settled on Mansions of Madness second edition for many, many reasons. Although it isn't a perfect game, there's a couple of improvements we all thought of. But there's still just as many contenders. Because, I mean, we played Adrenaline, Doom, and all of these fantastic games came out, as you say, and you're thinking, Jesus, they could all be, you know, Game of 2016 as far as we're concerned.
Sure, yeah. And they were in some people's list. And if you go back, say, 5 years, you know, was there that many great? I mean, there were good games, but were they great? I don't know. I just feel like it's our industry's evolving very quickly, and you know, the more we push, the better games we're going to get. So that's one of the reasons why when I feel like with Grimm Forest, it's a game that I don't feel like people are going to trade away. I feel like it kind of fits this certain niche in your collection that you could bring this out with almost anybody that you know and have a good time with it. So you're probably going to want to keep it. So on that end, I wanted to push the components to the best that they could be, because if I'm going to keep a game forever and it's going to look good on the table, that just makes it something that I'm going to play even more often. And I think a lot of people are taking that approach. I mean, obviously you've got like the Cthulhu Wars, who make something that's just insane, 14-foot tall minis.
Steve would probably buy it if it's got Cthulhu on it. He's all over it.
No, I passed on that one.
I'm sorry, what?
That was too rich for my veins, that was.
Oh, good Lord.
It was, I think, we're talking about shipping and input duty and things like that. I think that worked out around about £250 of add-ons the first time it came around.
No, that's a lot. Jeez. Then again, as I say, I back Deep Madness, and that's probably not far off it.
One of the things I did want to ask, we mentioned Gloomhaven, and we mentioned, what's it called, Terraforming Mars earlier. And since it's come out, been brought to light by both of these games, is those are two games, I think Great Western Trail is another one, where the publishers have really underestimated the demand of these games. Terraforming Mars, I reckon the second, I mean, Stephen Barnacore even, we're talking about the Facebook group, it's a UK board game Facebook group, and Stephen Barnacore even chipped in and gave his side of the story. And he basically said that, like, it's the most of any game he's ever printed, and he's now going for a third run, print run, which is like four times the original print run, but he still sold all these games. So what are you doing, basically, to try and, what do you do to judge or estimate how many games you think you're going to sell? Because as you said, you don't want to end up with a carriage full of cardboard just sitting there.
Sure. Well, you know, I mean, that's for me, being a company who will go to Kickstarter, that's exactly what Kickstarter does, right? I mean, I get a really good idea of what the market wants out of a game. Now I can take those numbers and I can go to my distribution companies and say, here's the numbers of what we put on, you know, that people backed on Kickstarter. How many do you guys want to pre-order on your end? And then I can add that on top for retail, and then I can add a few more to make sure that I have some to kind of refill after that initial surge. But if you're Stephen Bonacore and you don't have a Kickstarter, you don't know. You know, you're just throwing darts at a dartboard, because you know, he puts out, what, 15, 20 games a year? He's, you know, Terraforming Mars, when you look at it on paper, I think it just checked a lot of different boxes for people. Definitely wasn't the components, since that stupid cube slot everywhere, but it checks a lot of boxes, and obviously the success of the movie, The Martian, I think that coupled together quite nicely from a marketing standpoint, and then it just had some really fun mechanics. And Great Western Trail, same way. It just, you know, I wouldn't have out of the gate said that looked like a type of game that I would really enjoy, and after I played it at BGG Con, I was like, man, this game's fantastic. So you just, you really don't know, and you just produce what you can for the money, and then you just hold on and ride the thing out and make as many as you can as quickly as you can for the demand that's there. It's a good problem to have.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, it's totally, better than the other problem,
I've got 3,000 boxes of shite. Who wants one? Yeah.
It's happened. It's happened. I've spoken to a lot of British publishers who've done the kind of publishing their own. This is before Kickstarter, most of them. And they said, you know, they've ended up with a shed full of just cardboard boxes that they're never going to shift. The famous one is it Scandaroon? You ever heard of Scandaroon? Scandaroon is Tony Boydell's surprise stare game that was so bad, they even gave it away at the UK Games Expo to the first 100 people who got there. And by the end of like the second day, the bring and buy sale was full of copies of this.
Wow. I mean, how does that happen?
Yeah. You know, there's... It's really hard to judge exactly what the market is going to want. You know, it really is. So you just do the best that you can. And, you know, Steven, I feel like he's probably... the most well-equipped for prospecting. I mean, he's like ex-Wall Street, right, or something like that. So he should know the best there. But even Steven's going to miss every once in a while.
You've got to wonder, though, how a bad game hits the market, especially after what you've just said there, James. And I do agree with you that, you know, the standard's now getting so high that, you know, there's just no room for crap games. They just won't get funded. So, I mean, you've got to wonder, is anyone who's making a game... have you even play tested it? I mean, okay, you know, you get crappy video games as well, so you do wonder, does this company have a QA department? Does anyone bother to play this before release, you know?
Yeah, it's one of those things. I think a lot of people just, there's certain people that like games, you know, a certain way, because there's games that I play that I hate that I know there's huge crowds that love. So there's some of that, but then there's also, you know, some people, and I see it a lot. I've go to like a lot of the prototype cons and unpub cons and things like that. And some people just really don't know what looks good or what's fun. Like, they just really don't know. And, you know, they're really pushing. I'll have somebody come up and say, hey, look at this game. And, like, this game is terrible. This is the worst idea I've ever seen. But they're so excited. And I'm like, oh, gosh.
You just feel mean for shattering their dreams.
What is it, American Idol? You know, where somebody has told this little girl that she can sing all of her life, and she gets up in front of these judges and sings, and it's horrendous. And we all laugh and, it's, you know, have a good time. But it's just not true. She can't sing. And I think that happens to some extent, where some people don't want to be blunt with people and say, hey, this is a terrible idea. You really shouldn't go forward with this.
It is. It's difficult because, I mean, we get sent prototype copies as well. And Steve and I do obviously have conversations about, you know, what's your game like? Is this game? What do you think? You know, and... it's difficult to be diplomatic sometimes. You know, I mean, you want to be supportive because, I mean, you know, as you've said before, you know, you put something down in front of somebody and you're cringing, you know, you cook them a meal or whatever, and you're like, oh, Jesus, I hope, you know, I don't poison them or anything. And it's horrible to receive negative feedback about anything. And it's just as horrible to give negative feedback, really, because you don't want to ruin someone's day. But at the same time, you don't really want to allow something... you know, crap to hit the market, because, you know, it's not going to do anyone any good, least of all the developer.
Well, yeah, exactly. On their end, you're actually, so I try to take somewhere in between the Jamie Stegmaier approach and the James Math approach, right? Like, James Math is, I mean, he'll just punch people right in the face with, that's terrible, that's the worst game I've ever seen. And then you've got Jamie on the other end, who's super supportive and, like, you know, no, you can do it. Come on. You can just put a little more effort into it. So I try to be somewhere in between. But people really do need that feedback of, hey, this game's not very good, and you need to go back to the drawing board and work on this some more. Now, there's a lot of times, kind of what we were talking about earlier, where a game has interesting new mechanics, but they just haven't put enough work into it. And I will tell them, hey, it's not a good game yet, but you've got something here. Like, you've got something.
Yeah.
As opposed to someone who's taken Coup and added one tiny little twist to the mechanic, and they're ready to go to market with it. And I'm like, that's just not that's not enough game. I actually had one sent to me not too long ago that was, I don't know if you guys have ever played Roll For It, but a guy had added just one mechanic to the game Roll For It, and I'm like, that's just not enough to justify a new game on the market. It's just not. He didn't want to hear that either, though, but...
No, of course, some people don't take criticism very, very well at all.
Or at all?
I know.
At all. I would say not at all.
No.
it's nice to be able to say, you know, it's crap, but, you know, if you change this, then maybe it'd be better. Because it's nicer to go back with a bit of constructive criticism rather than just wailing on them all the time. But that said, you know, there are some things that are just truly awful.
That's right. If they're awful, then they need to be told that it's awful. And they decide to keep going with it. That's on them. You know, you did your part.
Yeah.
Mm.
And one of the things I tell in my when I do my keynotes, when I'm talking to potential publishers and designers, is that if you've got a game, like, so my first game, it had a dice in it to begin with, Barnyard Roundup. It's a family bluffing game. And it had a dice in it. And somebody in a playtest said, you know, this would be better without the dice. And, I mean, I thought they had shot my mother. You know, I was like, get the hell out of here. The dice is the best freaking part. You freaking jerk. I hate you. And so then I went home and I took the dice out and I played it and I was like, damn it, they're right. It is better without the dice. And so I removed that mechanic, and now the game's better, you know. But if I would have stuck to my guns and said, I'm putting that dice in there no matter what because I like the dice mechanic, the game would have suffered. So you've got to be willing to take those lumps.
Oh, it's the worst feeling in the world, isn't it, realizing that, you know, you've got your heart set on something and you try it without, and you're like, I hate that. It's, oh, damn it, they were right. No.
No, I've been wrong so many times in my life. I'm a pro.
So what's been the biggest shock when you playtested Grim Tales then?
Well, luckily, because this isn't my design, because I don't know if you remember, I told you I'm a redneck from Alabama. So somebody finding something wrong with my design probably makes sense. But Tim is not a redneck, and he's an actual intelligent person. And so he's worked out a very good game. I mean, he's even actually sent me some prototypes of some other games he's designing, and they're all really unique and really good. So I can already tell I'm gobbling him up. I'm going to try to lock him down and publish all of his games because he is a mad scientist with some cool stuff in there. You know, so I haven't really had any of those moments. Now, I will say that a guy on my team by the name of Ian Allen, he really ramped up some of the card development in the game and made it a little bit more gamer's game with some of the take that and some of the counters and some of your strategy. And so, you know, anything I think can be improved. Anything can be improved. So,
okay, so we've been jabbering on a bit for about an hour. So I think it's about time we wind things up. Before we go, when is your Kickstarter? Where can we look for it? And where can we find more stuff from Druid City Games?
So I have a website, www.druidcitygames.com. Anything that we've got going on there, we've got a newsletter. You can sign up for that. We don't spam people. You'll get something about once a month from us with updated news. Our Kickstarter is going to launch for Grimm Forest on March 21st, 9 a.m. Central Time for the state folks. So I guess that would be midday-ish for you guys, or mid-afternoon probably.
Wow. 2 p.m., maybe 3 p.m., because we're about 5 hours behind the East Coast. So, sorry, ahead of the East Coast.
Perfect. So, mid-afternoon, so March 21st. And I'm going to have there's a really cool, we're not doing an early bird or anything like that, but we do have a pretty legit day one backer giveaway that we're going to do. So, we're going to go into everybody who's in the first day backers, pull out a random name, and we've got a custom mini that we've blown up to like 125 millimeter type situation. It's huge, and it's going to be custom painted and sent out to a lucky first day backer. So
I am all over that.
it's really awesome. It's probably like 7-8 inches tall. Again, that probably means nothing to you guys. We're the only idiots that use inches over here.
20 centimeters, that's fine. We still use inches and feet. We're not totally metricized yet, although we're getting there.
Yeah, I've been an engineer most of my life, and you have to keep swapping between the two of them. So
be different. It's just us. It's just us. Like, I don't.
It is. Yeah, it is. It is. You need to have a word with your new administration. Listen, Trump, sort it out. Everyone else is using centimeters. Why can't we?
I got a whole bunch of words for my new administration.
I think the rest of the world might join you as well.
Yeah. That's a whole other podcast right there, boys and girls.
Oh, yeah. Well, we've got our own problems as well, so kindred spirits and all that.
You know, we can all get together and suffer together, I guess.
All right. Right, we're going down another rabbit hole, Steve.
We are. Let's deploy the parachutes and get out of this as quick as possible.
If you ever need to go down a rabbit hole, you can ask me. I'm perfect for that.
Awesome.
Next week's podcast then, eh, boys?
Absolutely. Right then, same time next week.
Thank you very much, James, for joining us.
For having me.
Hopefully our dodgy, dirty northern accents haven't confused you too much.
Hopefully your listeners can discern all of my redneckanese.
Oh, it sounded good. I'm going to learn it, y'all. Y'all.
I'm going to go on holiday.
Yes, there we go. I say, what? Lovely.
I watched a lot of Austin Powers back in the day, too. So, hello. That's about it.
That's pretty much all we say over here.
That's it, right?
That's it. There's just like four words. Hello.
I've been told don't say bloody hell because that's like a full-on, all-out cussing. So I don't know. Maybe I said a bad thing.
Oh, hell no. That's gentle, that is. Oh, bloody hell. That is. Don't get me started. You'll never stop me. You'll have to replace your ears.
I've enjoyed it.
Andy's lived in Scotland for a few years. So,
yes, I've heard about Scots.
Once you start swearing properly, well...
Oh, yeah, the Scots use the F word as punctuation. It's brilliant.
Yeah, yeah.
Anyway, we're approaching that rabbit hole again, aren't we? Thank you ever so much, everyone, for listening. We'll be back soon with something from Aircon. We haven't quite decided what, because due to our ramshackle nature, yet again, we've not prepared, and we'll just see what happens when we get to the Games Convention. And then, of course, after that, we'll be doing a bit of a download of our thoughts of everything we played at the convention as well. What was the date again, James? 21st of March?
Yeah, thanks for having me.
So 21st of March, we'll ping out on Facebook and Twitter when you've launched Kickstarter. So that's at Polyhedron C, and we're on Facebook /Polyhedron Collider. Where can people find you on Twitter and Facebook, James?
Everything's Druid City Games. So just like a druid in the forest. D-R-U-I-D, druid.
Excellent. And thanks very much for listening, everyone. We'll see you in a couple of weeks. Tatty bye.
Take it easy.